it's a continuation of what probably Dr. Bhujang Shetty has talked about. And the principles that he talked about, being mindful and you being beyond your body and your mind, is the concept that I'm going to take it further and talk about how we actually need to use that in our medical profession. So let me start with this patient, a 14-year-old girl with a disc looking like that, and a visual fields that we did subsequently turned out to be normal, had a HRT, and we talked about the risk factors that are there in HRT and the risk factor of the intraocular pressure being in the higher teens and the CCT being on the lower side and the multiple risk factors that we talked about because of the CCT and things like that. This patient actually ended up having an SLT in both the eyes. A 14-year-old girl, engineering father, moves to a neighboring country and his only daughter gets an SLT, and the internet search shows that it's a blinding condition. The whole family is ruined. So if this child did not have glaucoma, why did we diagnose it as glaucoma? And if this child did not need therapy, why did we actually treat with something? And in what context are we practicing medicine at this point of time? What's the ecosystem? I think those are the three things that I want to address. The biases that we undergo as we examine patients, and the overconfidence with which we treat our patients, and the lack of knowledge about what kind of a milieu that we are working in. So the mindfulness that Bhujang Shetty talked about, if you have to give a decision, one should become master of one's mind rather than let one's mind master him, is a saying that is given. So essentially, you are not your body, you are not your mind. You are something beyond your body and your mind, and that's what you need to control. And this is an age-old concept that he talked about. Plato talked about how our mind and body have to be controlled by our soul or whatever you want to call it. And the Upanishads talk about these are our senses, and your mind controls your senses through, your intellect controls your senses through your reins, through the reins of the horse, and you are actually the owner of the chariot. And you are not one of those things. So the whole body constitute all those things. So this, if it looks very esoteric for you and you want to be secular, sorry. This is the current neuroanatomist psychologist's work that talks about how our mind works and how we can understand how our mind works to be actually more productive. With that background, if you want to look at how you examine your patients and what goes on in your mind when you examine your patients, these are all the kinds of biases that we go through. I will talk about the first four biases subsequently in detail, but the last two, attribution error and the affective error, are the ones that we need to address briefly. I'm taking care of my wife's close friend. I compromise on not doing a gonioscopy because I don't want them to have a problem. I don't do the complete examination because this person that I'm seeing is somebody very close to me or a VIP. And I have a patient whom I have given 6-6 vision with a beautiful surgery, and he keeps on cribbing about this is not good, that is not good, and things like that. Spoils the moods of all my patients sitting in the waiting hall. If he comes with a silent central lateral vein occlusion, because of the bias that I have, attribution, that this guy is a painful soul, I will miss the diagnosis there. So that affective and the attributive errors that we are subject to, we need to remember. The important ones are the hope and the expectation bias. The intraocular pressure is 18 or 19 or 19 or 20. Because I have done a trabeculectomy, I'll record 17 or 18. The intraocular pressure is 18 or 19. Because the patient is a glaucoma suspect, I'll record 20 or 21 so that I can start treatment. So what am I expecting and how am I recording? And what is my hope and what is I am recording? So those are the biases that are very important that we need to remember. Is there an antidote to that? The antidote to that is the null hypothesis that we keep using in clinical research. The null hypothesis is generated because of two reasons. One, we want to know whether the results that we get is because of chance, or will it be true if I extrapolate to a larger population. And two, the concept that you cannot prove anything in this world. You can only disprove something. Because of that, you create an alternate hypothesis against your favorite hypothesis, and you try to disprove your alternate hypothesis so that you can accept the favorite hypothesis or null hypothesis. Favorite hypothesis. The alternate is the null hypothesis. If you want to prove that all crows in this world are black in color, you need to actually enumerate all the crows. And if you do a Google search, you will find a white crow. So what you need to do is, if my favorite, when we look for a clinical finding, or when you want to say that young girl had glaucoma, what is the evidence against glaucoma in that young girl? If you want to say that the young girl needs SLT, what is the evidence against that the girl needs SLT? Those are the challenges that we need, those are the thought process that you need to go through before you actually say that you accept that finding. At the end of the day, I'm looking at this patient with gonioscopy. I don't want to do one more iridotomy. I want to say that it is open angle glaucoma and start treatment. So that's my favorite hypothesis. Now the null hypothesis will tell me, what are the testing conditions? Is the room dark enough? Did I affect the pupillary size while doing the gonioscopy? That kind of a pigmentation on the back of the cornea and this kind of irregular pigmentation of the trabecular meshwork, is that normal or is it an intermittent angle closure? So if you invoke that null hypothesis, then you are unlikely to make the mistakes that you would make with your hope bias and expectation bias. The confirmation bias and search satisfaction are the other things that are very important. Because you see a positive finding, you do not examine further. Because the patient has come with a diagnosis X, you don't want to challenge the diagnosis. So that confirmation bias and search satisfaction are the other two things that one needs to guard themselves against. From that perspective, I think, if you want to know from the neuroanatomy how our minds work, our minds move at lightning speed. Ironically, that often slows down our learning because we leap to generalizations or conclusions very quickly. How does that work? System 1 and system 2 that Daniel Kahneman talks about. The immediate reaction or immediate diagnosis that comes to your mind needs to slow down and look for the alternative. So this is a simple puzzle that is given in that book. The cost of a bat and ball together is $1.10. The cost of the bat is $1 more than that of the ball. What's the cost of the ball? The immediate answer that will come to you is 10 cents. If that is 10 cents, the total would be $1.20, not $1.10. If you slow down, the correct answer will be 5 cents for the ball. Then the answer falls in place. That kind of a slowing are we doing each time we examine a patient and jump to a surgical conclusion before we move on further. Changing gears completely is a beautiful thesis from Boston. And what they did actually was had 47 residents on a mannequin about to undergo appendicectomy. And before the surgical incision is made, the oxygen drops. So the challenge to these anesthesia residents is identify the cause of that hypoxia and then treat it. 29-year-old young girl, history of asthma. What happened to those residents? The way only 7 of the 47 residents could actually survive the test. In all the others' hands, the patient actually died. And the thought process that went on in those residents at that time is the subject of that thesis. So group 1, they get stalled. Like what happens to us when we have a vitreous loss? Our mind stops working. We don't know what's the next step, what we need to do subsequently. The second group of people are fixated. They can think of only bronchospasm and nothing else. And then keep on giving multiple doses, different medications for bronchial asthma only and nothing else. Bronchial spasm only and nothing else. Bronchospasm. The third group is a diagnostic vagabond. What do we do with our infectious keratitis? One day antibiotic, one day antifungal, third day steroid, fourth day antiviral. We keep on changing the treatment. So a diagnostic vagabond does not take any diagnostic to its logical conclusion, but keeps on varying. The only guy who can succeed is who can think of multiple conditions for that etiology and actually take each of them to the logical conclusion. The adaptive guy is the one who can actually survive the patient. So that is the kind of the learning that comes from that when we are in a diagnostic setup is the 3D approach. What data am I considering? Most of the talks that were given in the morning talked about whether we asked the history correctly, whether we are looking at the complete clinical picture or not. So what kind of data are we considering before we making the diagnosis? And what all differential diagnoses have we considered? If you don't consider that differential, some of them, you won't even make the diagnosis. And ultimately, the direction that we are taking, is it safe for the patient or not? We need to step back and ask that question. What's the worst case scenario? Am I covering for that? Moving on, why did that girl actually get an SLT which she did not need? The therapeutic illusion. As the surgical techniques keep on improving, and as we become very confident and very good at the surgical techniques, we keep on increasing the indications for those surgeries. Some of them are not probably valid. So the illusion of control and the benefit that the patient might have with that therapy is, I think, something that we need to be careful about. At least in my days, the art and attitude of good patient care was learned by evolution. I don't know if those role models are still around, or they may be dwindling. But if those role models are not there, can introspection substitute that emulation? And from that introspection point of view, going by what the girl went through, the thought process that we need is to prevent ourselves from thinking that all interventions are potentially, that are potentially beneficial are justified. Interventions that are potentially beneficial are justified, we justify them. Interventions is justified if it is unlikely to cause harm to the patient. I want to do yak pay in every patient that comes to my clinic, imagining an angle closure. And because of the, if you follow that route, expensive non-validated diagnostic and therapeutic interventions become overused. And that's a cost to the patient as well as cost to the community that I will talk about subsequently. What kind of an ecosystem are we working in? Medical ecosystem has become healthcare industry. We have to accept it. Healthcare is now an industry. And the challenge we have is, can we bring care back to the healthcare? If it is industry and it is going to ask only for growth, for any industry or for any of this thing, growth is imperative. And growth is proportional to the amount of energy that we use in this planet. If the total amount of incremental energy is 2% on the planet from last year to this year, the growth globally is 2%. Somebody grows 20%, somebody grows 2%, somebody grows, does not grow at all, goes into recession. That's something that we need to remember. And we need to remember also that growth for the sake of growth is like cancer. The paradigm of growth being mandatory, I think, has a problem in itself. How does it translate to what we are talking about? I have grown from ICCE days to topical phaco. Excellent improvement in quality of life. But I also grew from iPhone 4 to iPhone 6 now, not 10. I want to get iPhone 10. Is the incremental value from iPhone 4 to iPhone 10 same as incremental value from ICCE to topical phaco, or from SICS to phaco, or from a unifocal IOL to multifocal IOL, and things like that? So that incremental value to the patient and the cost involved is a question that we need to ask. Unfortunately, we don't. Because the way the government keeps creating the SEZs and the whole world is using natural resources without any cost to the planet, it is said that if those industries are actually built, invoiced for the natural resource they are using, it will be $72 trillion per year. And all that resources from the nature are coming free to us. In a different perspective, the amount of natural resources that we are using at this point of time is equivalent to 1.5 times the earth. And if you continue at this rate to grow, by 2050, we will need 5 to 7 planets to survive our hunger for growth. To make things more simple and understandable, all of us are struggling for water, right? There were days when water was freely available, now we have to buy water. To prepare one bar of chocolate, it takes 2,700 liters of water. So that is how we are using the natural resources, unaccountable completely. So from the point of view of that, as we practice medicine, what is the incremental value to the patient and how are we aggressively marketing whatever is the new thing that is sold by the industry is what we need to be careful about. A very mouthful sentence, two slides are very busy ones, but I would urge you to read actually the second part. While all of us are scientific and are going evidence-based medicine, the second part is more important. The doctor's responder will act in a more intuitive manner. The responder is sensitive to internal messages determined by the doctor's feelings, emotion, and how this affects the interpretation of the information in a way that recognizes context, experience, apprehension, failures, and success. So if I want to justify a femtosecond cataract surgery, if I want to justify a multifocal IOL in a patient, I am the responder. I am not the organizer. I am not going by evidence-based medicine alone. I use evidence-based medicine, but I interpret it in a way that I can justify whatever I am doing for the patient. The same thought in a different perspective. Our intuitions decide, our organizer decides, our responder decides what we want to do. And then our rational mind justifies whatever we've decided to do. So our logic is only to justify the decision that we have made. Our logic is not to find the truth. That's what we need to remember. So from that context, in this paradigm of patient care, the academia, once we keep publishing papers, the industry that, and the physicians, individual practitioners, all of us keep saying that we are all patient-centric. We want to do the best possible for the patient. But what we don't realize is that all of us have our own biases, and our intelligence will never fail. Whatever costly technology we want to use, whatever is the incremental value to the patient, we will justify it. And the patient has no voice whatsoever. In that paradigm, actually, it occurs to me, when I first went to US in 1989, ECCE was the norm, and the surgeon's fee was $2,000. Now with topical phaco, the surgeon's fee has come down to $500 to $600. The cost of surgery has increased, but what the doctor makes has reduced. The incremental value is something that we need to worry about. Where is that money going? That money is being shared by the insurance company, the industry, and the middlemen and everybody. What are we doing? We are hand in glove with them. Because we keep selling things that probably we are not completely justified, or we don't even stop to think whether it is justified or not. The immediate goal is to be competitive, get the next technology, and then start doing it, and doing it more than the neighbor is doing. If we follow that route without stepping back and thinking as to where we started and what's the incremental cost to the society and how long this planet can survive, we don't own this planet, right? We have taken it on rent from our next generation. What are we leaving for them? Is what we need to be worried about. So from that context, the incremental value to the patient is what we need to be worried about, and I seriously worry that we are not in the driving seat. In the medical profession as it is practiced now, we, the doctors, are not in the driving seat. We are driven by the insurance companies and we are driven by the industry. So we need to realize that. From that perspective, though we keep talking about informed consent, whatever way you talk about it, ultimately we decide what the patient gets. Whether the patient gets a multifocal IOL, whether the patient gets a femtosecond cataract surgery, whether the patient gets a Lucentis rather than an Avastin. We decide. And the way we decide is decided by someone else, that unfortunately. So that's what we need to be careful about. To go back to the original thought that Bhujang Shetty talked about, the greatest unexplored territory in the world is the space between your ears. The ability to reflect on one's thinking while acting, as you examine a patient, as you decide to do a therapy, why am I doing it? If you are able to do that, that distinguishes the truly outstanding professionals. So to conclude, if we all believe that service to man is service to God, and hopefully 99% of us sitting in this room are not atheists, we are all religious people, and we believe that service to man is service to God, when we are in front of a patient, how many of us feel the God in the patient that we are treating? That's the final question. Time to introspect. Thank you.